Thank you guys for coming. I'm Allison. I'm a dietitian here at Mariano's. I've been with the company for about 2 years now. We are a big sponsor of the marathon, so that's why we do these classes. Also, it's a little bit selfish, but I'm a big fan of the marathon. I've run 12. I like to say I've done everything you can do wrong and everything you can do right. So from personal firsthand experience, I also have that. So feel free to ask questions. We're pretty informal. What I'm going to do today is basically walk you through a couple recipes, but also this presentation. So I know I gave you a lot of different handouts, but this is what I'll focus on. So if you want to walk through with me, this is what I'll be talking about. A little bit about my background, and I'm sorry about all the noise. There's not much I can do. We're a working grocery store. So as far as my background, I've been a dietitian for 11 years. I've worked in every job you can have as a dietitian, everything from clinical to the YMCA to school districts, recently PR communications. And after about 5 years of that, I decided I missed working with people. So I came to Mariano's and I've been here ever since. What I really love about my job is I can have an impact on what goes in your cart right when you're making the purchase decision, which is kind of cool. So that's a little bit about my background. I'm going to talk to you about what to do before, during, and after the race, but you guys probably have your 20 miler coming up very soon. So what is most important and what I hope you take away is that practice makes PRs. What you do in your practice of your long run is going to help you get that PR on race day. And does everyone know what PRs stands for? Okay. Groups of non-runners have no idea. They're like, public relations, it could be anything. So we'll talk about what you're going to do before, what you're going to do during, what you're going to do after, a little bit about carb loading, hydration, and then Q&A, because I think Q&A is probably the most important. You guys probably have some more specific questions. So if you're going to tell you what you're eating first, and then we'll go into the presentation. So the first dish is overnight oats. So I basically start with breakfast, right? So this would be something I have had. I also have a private practice and I work with some runners one-on-one and do presentations outside of Mariano's occasionally. And this one is one that I have worked with some runners, and some runners can tolerate it if they have it 90 minutes to 2 hours before a workout. Any closer and it sometimes will be a little too heavy, a little too much. So it just depends on you. So you should know what you're going to do on race day for breakfast, and you should definitely eat breakfast, but we'll get into that later. But this is one option that you could do. I actually like overnight oats as an option, something that I have as a recovery after a morning workout where I'm not that hungry before. I'm only going for a 6 to 8 mile run. It's ready when I get home. I just grab it out of the fridge and it's like done. So it's one of my favorite things to do that's just like a grab and go too. So if you don't have a lot of time in the morning, it's a great combination. So I use Siggy's yogurt, which is, this is the vanilla. It's 0% fat, very high in protein. It's one of the only yogurts that can tout that it actually has more protein than sugar. So per one cup, which the smaller cups that you buy in the store, those are not going to be about a cup. They're going to be closer to 5 or 6 ounces. But for one cup, you get 24 grams of protein. This is a lot of protein in a small package. And very little sugar. So I'll emphasize that. I like getting sugar from naturally occurring sources as much as possible, and very little from those that you add. So added sugar is 14 grams. Some of that's lactose, which is naturally occurring in the dairy, but it's a very low sugar yogurt, which is really great. And I like it because it does have higher amounts of protein. It's like Greek yogurt, so it's strained, so that's why you get more protein from it. You've got a coupon for it, so they don't pay me to say any of that. It's just a product that I really like, so that's why I'm kind of promoting it. I mix it with the Fairlife milk. You could also use almond milk if you wanted. I like the Fairlife because, again, it's just a higher protein option. It's also lactose-free if you have a lactose intolerance. What they do is they ultra-filter and ultra-pasteurize the milk, so it actually has a little bit more protein. Also, the shelf life is much longer because of that pasteurization process. So it's really great if you're like me and you buy a gallon of milk and you'll never go through the whole thing. This will keep in your refrigerator for quite a while. I think the sell-by date, we picked this up today, is through January, which is pretty crazy. So it does keep, it tastes like milk, it's no different, it is milk, that's why. And then I add chia seeds, good source of omega-3s, really great with inflammation and recovery, so it's going to help your soreness go down and hopefully recover a little bit faster between workouts. Obviously there's oats in it, it's overnight oats. A little bit of lemon juice for flavor, some frozen blueberries, they'll defrost overnight, so they won't be frozen anymore. Hopefully they weren't still frozen when you guys had them. And then in the morning, I'll drizzle honey and nuts over it. So you got hazelnuts today. The recipe, I was going to tell you, the recipes I will send to you all because I didn't have enough recipe cards for everything, but that way you don't have any more papers because I gave you enough papers as it is. So I can send you all the recipes after the class. So that's it with the overnight oats. Have you guys made them before? You can modify this by adding different fruits. You could add nut butter to it. You could add, I like making it with banana and peanut butter or almond butter. So you could really just play around with this. I got the idea from Pinterest. So there's a ton of overnight oat recipes, but just a great breakfast to have either recovery meal or in a, before a long run. Just remember, from experience with the runners I've worked with, give it about 90 to 2 hours time frame. So, all right. Yep, mix it cold, keep it in the fridge overnight. Yep, really easy. So the chia seeds absorb the water. When you put it in the jar, it's going to be pretty liquidy, and then overnight it becomes more like the thickness of the yogurt. Yeah, it's pretty good. It's like muesli. If you've ever had muesli in Europe, that's the same kind of idea. Okay, so now I'm going to get into the presentation now that you have a little something in your stomach. You're drinking tart cherry juice and club soda, and I'll talk about why tart cherry juice is so great in a second. So there's that little cute cartoon, running tacos and beer. I like to say I run because I love to eat, but I also love to run. So we don't want to always, you know, run a marathon. You can have 17 tacos and 4 Coronas. Not maybe the best way, and I'll talk about recovery in a minute, but that's just a kind of fun way to talk about things to begin with. So as I mentioned, I am a runner as well. I'm actually on the DW running team, which is a local team with a coach locally. So I won't be running Chicago this year. I've run it the last 3 years. So if you have any questions about that race in particular, I can also answer those. But I'm training for a December marathon instead this year. It's very hard. It's going to be very hard. I may have to leave the state on the day of the marathon. No, I'm kidding. I'm also a real food lover, and my basic nutrition philosophy is fill up on fruits, vegetables, and whole grains first. Use protein for recovery, quality sources of carbohydrates, and really just don't be scared of fat. That's one thing I think runners, for a long time, we all eat really super lean, high carb, low fat diets, and it is important to have some fat, and I'll talk about why in a second. All right, so this is going to be super fast because I find the Nutrition 101 is super boring and people fall asleep on me. So just some basics about nutrition. Look at food and beverage as fuel. So just like a car, you wouldn't start your car on empty. Your body in the morning, especially before a long run or any run over an hour, very hard starting on empty. So encourage food and beverage as fuel. Nutrient density is important too. So that means getting the most nutrition you can for your calorie buck. All right, so you could have a Big Mac and have 400 calories that way, or you could have a big salad with some protein, lean protein, fruits and vegetables. You're getting a lot more vitamins, minerals, and nutrition. So that's the kind of, so the same amount of calories, but you're getting a lot more dense, nutrient-dense foods. What you consume today does matter down the road, so you might not be thinking too far in advance, but it does add up over time, right? So we want to make sure we're eating things today that are going to help us down the road. Have a plan. That's really key for everything nutrition related. I think a lot of people get into ruts and they don't have a plan, and then you end up eating out all the time. So it is really important to try and have a plan most days of the week. Focus on variety, so you'll achieve peak performance by training and eating a variety of foods. You don't do all the same workouts, right? We don't just run all easy runs. Hopefully there's some other harder stuff built in. If you follow most training plans, there's different lengths of runs, distances and speed. So it's very similar with food. We don't want to just eat one thing. You want to eat a variety. Experiment now, not on race day. I'll stress that like a few more times, but that's pretty important. I wore like a new pair of shorts one day on race day. That was a big mistake. So just make sure, like, you know, you wouldn't do those things. Don't do that with your food either. And then but don't take it too seriously. Food's meant to be enjoyed. I love a good burger, pizza. I have pizza earrings in. Like, I love food. I just also know how to balance it. So keep that in mind too. So Nutrition 101, carbohydrates, that's your main source of energy during exercise. So that's why it makes up the base of our diet and why we should really be focusing on that. And I still believe that, even though I know there's like paleo and all these other diets that are very low carb, high protein, as runners, we just need more. We need carbohydrates. So I do emphasize carbohydrates still, specifically whole grains when you can. If you haven't been used to eating whole grains or high fiber carbohydrates, though, now's probably not the time to start to increase significantly. Gradually increase, otherwise you're going to have some stomach issues, which is no fun, especially during a run. They should make up the bulk of your diet. There's some specific numbers there. Like I said, focus on whole grains when you can. And sources of carbohydrate would be things like bread, cereal, rice, pasta, but also dairy products can have a significant source of carbohydrate, as well as some fruits and vegetables. So those are going to be the base of your diet. Protein, really important. You've probably heard this. Get your protein after the run for muscle repair, recovery. You'll see the numbers there. It should be about 20% of your intake for the day. One thing that's coming out in the research that's really interesting is that people who spread their protein out over the day versus most of us, we eat like our main protein meal at dinner. People who spread it out over the day have a better time of controlling their appetite as well as maintaining their weight. So if you've never done that before, I'd encourage you to like try and get your protein a little bit more spread out through the day. Something that helps me, especially when you're getting close to those high mileage weeks and you're really hungry all the time, focusing on spreading the protein out is really helpful. And then endurance athletes need a little bit more than regular athletes because we are breaking down muscle and tissue all the time. So it's important to get a little bit more protein than the average person. But you don't need to go, like, protein shakes are great. This is just one brand that we sell. But I think they're great. For me personally, after an hour-long hard workout, I don't have much of an appetite. So I find the protein shake is actually a really easy way for me to get nutrition in when I have no appetite. But oftentimes, if I just have an easy run, I'll time the run so it's right before dinner, and then I just make dinner or breakfast. But I used to not believe that much in protein shakes, and now I kind of see where they can fit. So the one thing I will say with the protein shakes, read the ingredient list. Some of them, it'll just look like a laundry list. It'll be like 100 things that you can't pronounce. One that we don't sell it here at the store, but whey protein is one of the best proteins that you can have as a recovery, and it's called BiPro. I bought that online, and I love it because it's two ingredients. So look for something that's minimal ingredients, things you can pronounce. Whey protein comes from milk. It's one of the fastest absorbed by your muscles, so that's one of the reasons why they promote it. Okay. Other sources of protein, obviously meat, yogurt, Greek yogurt especially, milk, nuts, seeds, nut butters. I eat so much nut butter, it's ridiculous. I probably have like 5 jars of different flavors in my apartment at one time, but that is something I really like. And as endurance athletes, when you do get in those higher mileage, just to keep the calories up, nut butters are actually a really good way to get some concentrated source of calories. So that's it for protein. Fat, really important for protecting our organs, keeping our hormones in check, fat-soluble vitamin absorption, our skin and our hair healthy. For runners, it's also important when we really do get in those high mileage that we make sure we're including fat, especially women. That's one of the reasons a lot of the female elite athletes will lose their periods and their menstrual cycle, because it gets all screwed up. It's because they're having a very low-fat diet and not quite enough of the good fats in their diet. So really focusing on good fats, so things that, you know, fats like avocados, olive oils, nuts, seeds, really focusing on those. And it should be at least 15% of your diet, your calorie intake should come from fat. So sources of fat, I already mentioned olive oil. Things like butter or the saturated fat. So if it's saturated at room, if it's solid at room temperature, that means it's saturated. Those we've known for a long time that that is what contributes to heart disease. But some new research is coming out that it might not be as bad as we once thought. Why I love nutrition and why I hate it sometimes is the research is always changing. So I'm still on the fence with that. I would still caution you, if you're going to have butter, any kind of those saturated fats, just to be careful, go easy on it. Don't go crazy. Okay, so that's 101. I bored you to death. Oh no, there's vitamins and minerals. So the first three are the ones that give us calories. Vitamins and minerals are considered micronutrients, so they don't give us calories, but they do perform some important functions in our body. So the one's really important for athletes, sodium and potassium. You've probably heard that before. That's for electrolyte imbalance, really important to keep our keep you in check while you're running. When your electrolytes get off, then you get weird. My lips went blue after grandma's because I'd sweat so much this last June. It was a 85 degree race by the end of it. So it's really important to keep your electrolytes in check. Sources of sodium, not something we worry about too much, but maybe in really hot weather. So you might want to try, if you are a salty sweater, and we'll talk about that in a little bit, maybe having a little bit more sodium the day before your race if it's super hot. But potassium would be things like bananas, potatoes, oranges. If you're getting your fruits and vegetables in, you're probably getting enough potassium. Iron, really important for red blood cells, energy metabolism. Ladies, if you feel like you're really run down, it may be because of low iron. So that's something to get checked, though, for sure. I do eat meat, red meat, probably twice a week, just because I've found that that helps me with my iron stores. I've gotten really run down in the last few weeks, and that's the best way for me to get iron. But totally can get iron from spinach, nuts, seeds. I would even encourage some women to take a supplement with some iron in it, just not a lot because it is very constipating. And I'm sorry, there's not that many. There's a few guys here, but obviously that's one I know a lot about. Magnesium, really important for metabolic processes. Again, if you're getting a variety of foods in your diet, you're probably getting most of these, but you could take a multivitamin as what I would call an insurance policy. I'm not against that, especially as runners. But I still wouldn't say do that instead of eating your fruits and vegetables. It's something you do in addition to eating your fruits and vegetables. And then antioxidants is one I always encourage. That's why I gave you the tart cherry juice. They're just really good at fighting that free radical damage that your body is doing when you do any kind of physical activity. So fruits and vegetables are going to be the best source of that. So it's why I start with fruits and vegetables all the time. Okay, pre-workout. Anybody not eat breakfast before they run? Have a hard time. Okay, so we're all doing breakfast. That's good. Because race day, what does it start at? 7:30? Earlier? What time is it made? 7:30? So you want to eat pretty early, right? So you want to make sure you're getting up, you're having that decent breakfast about 60 to 90 minutes at least before. So you have a big window for yourself to digest. The goal with pre-workout is that you're going to prevent hunger and stabilize your blood sugar because you don't want to go into the race on empty, right? So 1 to 4 hours before, really you're focusing on carbohydrates. And so this recommendation is kind of the opposite of what I would normally always recommend, but you want something that's not super high in fiber. So this is when it's okay to go for white toast if that's what you tolerate. You don't want, like, this is not when you have fiber one before a long run, because that's when we're going to have some issues. So avoid really super high fat, high fiber foods, but you should know your tolerance. I can handle whole wheat toast with peanut butter and some chia seeds and banana. That's my go-to race day breakfast. But not everybody could tolerate that. So it's really about playing around with what works for you. Caffeine, I have to have at least a cup, maybe two, before a workout. Otherwise, you don't want to be near me. But it's also just, it wakes me up. It gets me out the door. So caffeine, small amounts have actually been known to increase your energy, especially while you're in the middle of doing exercise. So that's why you see some of the gels and goos now add caffeine to them. So it does give you a little bit of an extra kick. So I would say that that's okay, but know your limit. If you're someone who drinks a cup of coffee and gets the jitters, it might not be for you. But definitely something to try. I tried it for the first time in a race. Again, not the smartest idea. And it definitely gave me that kick, but almost was like, what is wrong with me? So you definitely need to try around with things. And then 60 minutes before, so say you get up really early and you have your breakfast at 4:30 and the race isn't until 7:30. An hour, 45 minutes out, you could definitely have one of these gels. I'll do a banana about an hour out because I can't eat everything at 4:30. I'm too nervous. So it's just about figuring out what works for you. And you could also want to maybe start hydrating. Have some Gatorade, have some water. You should be hydrating all morning, but this is when you really start to focus on it. Okay. Do I need to carb load? Since we're talking about pre-workout, carb loading is pretty complicated to do if you really want to do it right. You have to basically have a very high protein, high fat diet, very, very, very low in carb for like the 3 days at the beginning of the week of your race. you're basically depleting your stores of all the glycogen that's in there so that you can load it up, almost super load yourself. So after those 3 days and you feel really lethargic and just like, ugh, don't want to be around anyone, that's when you switch to the polar opposite. So you have very little protein, very little fat, and just all the carbs in the world. And then you're really super loading your body with the glycogen, which is what your body uses when it's working out. We hit the wall when our glycogen stores get depleted. So that's the wall that everyone talks about at mile 20. As long as you're fueling throughout the race, you hopefully won't hit that wall. You've practiced, you know what to fuel, you know your timing, you're putting in more nutrition. So people really hit the wall back when we didn't have these nutrition products available to us. It was more a common occurrence. You don't hear it as much. People definitely still hit the wall, but you don't hear it as much. So it's because we do have all these nutrition products available to us. So make sure you figure out a plan for your race day nutrition. And I'll talk about the during in a second. So I wouldn't necessarily say you need to totally focus on making sure you follow that carb load to a T, but I would say it is good to have more carbohydrates the week of the race. If you are used to having a big spaghetti dinner, go and have a big spaghetti dinner. Just don't eat so much that you feel like, oh my God, I can't move. That's probably not super smart the night before the race. But you know, eat an adequate amount of carbs. I will walk around the expo just eating pretzels. If I get hungry, I just munch on pretzels. So normally I would do like trail mix or something. Now I switch over to just really carb focused foods. So that would be my recommendation. You don't necessarily need to do the full on carb load. Also, if you do it right, you'll walk to the race day and you'll be 5 pounds heavier than you normally are if you're doing the carb load right, because carbohydrates retain water. So you are going to feel a little bit heavier, but trust in your training. You're fine. You'll be in with a matter of a couple miles, you won't feel that heaviness anymore. But that is a fun thing to feel 5 pounds heavier the week of the marathon. Also, you'll feel like everything's broken. I don't know if you've guys experienced that before, but everything's about to break. Everything hurts. There's no way I'm running a marathon, but it works. You'll be fine. Mid-workout, avoid the bonk. So don't wait until you run out of gas. Make sure you're taking in nutrition. So my recommendation is every 30 to 45 minutes, take something, whether it's a little couple sips of Gatorade, whether it's a gel. I time mine to be about every 40, 45 minutes. I'll take one block. Not the Gatorade ones that are here, but some the Cliff ones, very similar, and I'll take one of those. I actually ran one race without taking anything. I was having some stomach issues, so all I did was take Gatorade. It's just very different. I wouldn't recommend that. It is how I PR'd, but I'm pretty sure it wasn't because of the way I fueled. That was more just adrenaline at that point. But I would recommend every 30 to 45 minutes taking some kind of nutrition. Starting at the 45-minute mark. So gels, goos, blocks. I talk about applesauce, raisins, these little energy bites. If you could actually get those in your pockets, like, but it's going to be hard. They'll probably become a mushy mess. So whatever works for you. Some cyclists have done raisins before. And got it? The raisins actually have shown similar effects as Cliff Bar, of the Cliff Shots, as the gels, because you're basically just getting that glycogen in. The thing with raisins that you might miss out on are those electrolytes. So these have really been formulated for those of us that are running. They've got the electrolytes in it. Look at me, sponsor Gatorade. Okay. So avoid the bonk by really figuring out the timing of your food and nutrition. Make sure when you take those gels, goos, blocks, whatever, you're taking it with some water. It's going to help you absorb it and digest it a little bit better. Hydration. So going into your 20-miler, I'd encourage you to weigh yourself before you run the 20-miler and then weigh yourself after to figure out if you're hydrating adequately. If you're hydrating adequately, you won't gain any weight, but you won't lose any weight either. I've known people who are super, like I mentioned before, salty sweaters have lost 5-10 pounds in a race. That means we're just not hydrating adequately. Yes, you're probably going to lose a few pounds on the day of the marathon. It just happens. It's hard to really hydrate perfectly, but we don't want to see a huge drop in weight because then we know you're pretty dehydrated. The other way to test this is anyone checked. I know it's a little, if you don't have color here, but I can send the presentation, is the hydration, is checking your pee, the color of your pee. It should be pretty normal color. If it's really concentrated on this side of the spectrum, then we know we're pretty dehydrated. It's time to start hydrating ASAP. If it's on this side, you might be over hydrating. And if you're thirsty, it's too late. So my goal is usually aiming for about half a cup every 15 to 20 minutes. That's just a couple swigs. There will be stops every single mile. You don't need to always take it. Depends on the day. I always take the water, just take a little sip, and the rest goes on my neck if it's a hot day. And then the Gatorade, again, that's something that you need to practice in your 20-miler. I might take Gatorade every 3 stops. So not every single one, but some people take it every single one. It just depends on you and how much you sweat. For me, it's also about, well, how fast am I going? I don't know if I need to take the Gatorade this time. How crowded is the aid station? Sometimes for the first 2 miles, I'll carry a bottle of water because those water stops can become, I called the Berlin one full contact water spot. I played hockey all through high school, and it was like I had to use my checking skills to get a water. It was insane. So just make sure you have a plan for your hydration. But there is stops every single mile, so don't worry. There's stuff on course. You won't have to carry too much with you. Electrolytes, we talked about this a little bit, but if you feel any cramping, fatigue, nausea, dehydration, it may likely be due to your electrolytes. If that's something that's happening a lot, I had a guy on my team who was constantly nauseous and had dry heaves after every workout. They found out that he is a random case that needs a lot of sodium. He actually needs to take almost twice as much sodium as the rest of us. So he takes salt pills. Again, not something to try on race day, but if you think that might be something that you struggle with, try it out when you're doing your long run this weekend. See if it's something that helps you. He feels so much better. I haven't seen him dry heave. His performances are so much better. So it's an interesting case, but not everyone. All right, post-workout, you've probably heard, get your protein in. The sooner you can, the better. So I usually try to get something in within 60 minutes. If I don't have an appetite, it'll be the protein shake. If I do, I'll just have a meal. If you have a very rounded meal, like a well-rounded meal, you've got your protein, you're some carbohydrate, fruits and vegetables, you should be all set. But that 60-minute window is really when you're going to refuel your glycogen and repair your muscle stores the fastest. So that's why I always encourage going for that 60-minute window. It's not that you lose out after 60 minutes, but you start recovery a lot faster and you'll feel better. And it really is true. The faster you can, the better. So there's some examples of what your goals would be from a number standpoint. One of the things that you always hear is chocolate milk. And the reason being, it's a good, perfect combination of carbohydrate, protein, and a little bit of fat if you're doing the low-fat milk. So that's why they say chocolate milk, and if you like that, that's totally fine. I put some examples of very Mariano-specific meals. So this would be a beetberry smoothie, which I think we'll have a sample of shortly, and oatmeal with berries and almonds, which you can get from our Vero cafe bar. So say you finish and it's breakfast time, you could get that, or a breakfast sandwich and a kale fruit smoothie. So those are some examples of a decent breakfast. It's not the best, you know, as much as you want to go out and have the huge brunch with the eggs and omelets and home fries, and those are fine. It's just you want to be cognizant of like what you're putting into your body. I think a lot of people, I mean, I did it myself for a long time, where we just go out and we have brunch and I just burned 20, I ran 20 miles, I can have whatever I want. But remember that it's quality calories going in too. So you want some quality, not just quantity. On hydration status, there's me hydrating for the cameraman at Nashville. He actually asked me to do that. It was very awkward. But you want to rehydrate as soon as you can with 24 ounces per pound of weight loss within 6 hours. So that's just basically, I know after you finish the marathon, you want to celebrate, have a bunch of beers. It's okay, but make sure you counterbalance that with the water. Walk around for 2 days. I'll walk around just with a water bottle, always just sipping on the water bottle to rehydrate. You don't need to go overboard, but just make sure you're rehydrating. If you're really concentrated urine, you might want to maybe do some Gatorade, get your electrolytes back in check. You may need a little more than water. And we talk about protein, but it is also important to refuel your glycogen stores. So even though you've just been eating carbs for like a week straight and you're sick of looking at pasta, it is important to have some quality carbohydrates back in your diet to refuel your glycogen stores. Again, you'll feel better faster. So making sure those quality carbohydrates are getting back. So bread, pasta, you could do pasta if you're sick of pasta, rice. There's so many different carbs. You can do these like whole grains, quinoa, that kind of stuff. Totally fine. And then we already talked about protein. It helps repair muscles. So that's there. Some recovery smoothie ideas or recovery food ideas. On the next slide, talked about chocolate milk, talked about protein shakes, a homemade shake or smoothie. You've got a handout in your packet of handouts about how to make a smoothie. So that's a really nice handout that you can use as a tool to make a healthier smoothie. My big recommendation with smoothie is if you put all your smoothie ingredients out and you wouldn't sit down and eat all of those in one sitting, probably shouldn't drink it, right? So just make sure you're looking at that drink as almost like a meal, not a meal replacement. I like smoothies as a snack or something in addition to a breakfast option, but really just make sure you wouldn't, you know, that adds up real fast if you're not going to do that. Cereal, a sandwich. I've made a peanut butter sandwich and brought that along for a post long run. I've done that before. So there's a couple of different ideas there. If you have no appetite, there's some options that you can throw in your bag and just eat them as you can. So sometimes I remember when I finished Boston a few years ago, I wanted a ham sandwich and potato chips. So I figured out I was obviously lacking salt. I never like ham sandwiches. But that was the only thing that sounded good. Otherwise, I just wanted to lay down and pass out for the rest of the day. So I had that, and that was fine because that's what sounded good. If that's the only thing that sounds good, you should do that. Then there's a little note on speeding up recovery. So we talked a little bit about omega-3s. So that would be one thing that definitely can help with inflammation. So I try to do salmon or fatty fish at least once or twice a week. I also take omega-3 supplement. You don't need to go that route if you are definitely getting your fish servings in per week. They're not expensive. I do it more, again, as an insurance policy, but I'm still eating salmon. I'm taking in chia seeds pretty regularly as well. It's just kind of to help, hopefully, you know, the sooner I can get out and feel better, that's going to benefit you. Antioxidants, so from fruits and vegetables. And then a quick note about beetroot and tart cherry juice. So beetroot, beets. Has anyone heard about beets? Seen that out there? Seen people, like, so I actually have samples of this beet concentrate. It's a red, red powder that will just stain your fingers. It's supposed to increase your endurance during endurance activities, and it's most of the research has been done in cyclists, and they've shown that they've improved their times by like maybe a minute, 2 minutes. So not a huge gain, right? Over the course of a marathon that you're running for 26 miles, 1 minute, what's that? But it really comes, like, most of the people you see doing are those that are like that cutoff time or the elite athletes. I've tried it a few times. It made me feel like I was drinking, I don't know if it's caffeinated, but it just gave me what I thought was an energy boost. That could have been placebo, right? They told me it was going to help me, so I thought it felt better. But there is some research to support that it does increase endurance, but it's not a huge gain. So if it's something you want to try, I've had friends drink beet juice the whole week leading up to the race. Yeah, they PR'd, but was it the beet juice or was it because they did the training? It's kind of hard to tell. But it's something worth trying. You have to like beets. So if you don't like beets, beet juice tastes like dirt. It is not the, and we are actually going to try a beet smoothie from our smoothie bar in a few minutes. It has just a few beets in there, a lot of berries, a lot of bananas, so that'll mask the beet flavor. But you can still taste them. I've had customers say, no, I can't have that. It tastes like dirt. So you have to like beets. And then there's beet companies that make this beet supplement that you basically drink a shot about 45 minutes before the race and then see if it helps. So some research. Tart cherry juice, a little bit more research. Anti-inflammation, again, so it's going to help with recovery, soreness. People who have arthritis sometimes take tart cherry juice concentrate just to help with the inflammation there as well. I've been doing it for about 2 years. I make the drink that you're having. Sometimes I add a little adult beverage to it as well. You know, I don't know if it works, but it can't hurt, and I think it's just something that's kind of a nice thing to benefit. So it's supposed to help with inflammation. It's a whole food. You're not taking a supplement, so something nice. I do just do a little touch. This is our Roundies. Well, actually, we just merged with Kroger, so if you didn't hear that, but Simple Truth is our new, like, organic brand, like store brand, Simple Truth, and this is one we found in the juice section. This is from concentrate, but it's been reconstituted. You can also find in the produce section a really small bottle, but it actually serves like 15. 1 ounce is a serving. It looks like syrup. So I've been using that one the last few months, and it's a lot. You don't have to use quite as much. You only need a little touch. I always add it to club soda. It kind of dilutes it a little bit so that you can have a little bit more. Usually LaCroix, so if you like. I'm not, again, they don't pay me. That's just what I like. And that's it from recovery. And then just a recap on recovery. So we're post-race. It's time to fill up as soon as possible. Your glycogen stores are depleted, so you want carbs. You want some protein. If you have no appetite, try small things. But really, that window is 30 to 60 minutes. As soon as you can get something in, the better. Okay. So bottom line. I mentioned it a few times, but you have your big long run coming up. You should practice exactly what you're going to do on race day that morning. Obviously, if you realize something's off, you're going to change that before your race day. So just make sure you just try everything you're going to try in these training runs leading up to the marathon so that nothing is new on race day. What works for you won't work for others. My friend, this weekend we just did a little like run and photo shoot. He ate like an egg sandwich and we were running 20 minutes later, and I was like, how do you do that? That's so impressive. But he has a stomach of steel. I need 90 minutes before I can even think about walking out the door and digesting something. So it was frustrating because I ran on empty, and you watch him eating the sandwich and you're like, oh, I want to eat it. But anyway, so what works for you doesn't work for everyone. Treat your long runs and your workouts as an opportunity to try something new. Pre-workout, really focus on those carbohydrates. But I didn't mention this before, you do want some protein in that pre-race fuel because it's going to help your blood sugar stabilize. If you just have a bagel with nothing on it, we're going to have a spike, and then your blood sugar is going to go down and you're not going to feel real good in the middle of the race. So that's why I always have a little peanut butter. Some friends will do eggs. It's really just what works for you. So you do want a little bit of protein. It could be Greek yogurt. It could be just milk on your cereal, but definitely add in some protein in some form to your pre-race meal. During, really focusing on hydrating and adequate fuel. So taking in about half a cup of water every 15 to 20 minutes, having some kind of nutrition strategy, whether it's the shots, whether it's the chews, whether it's raisins, just having some kind of strategy and trying to do that every 45 to 60 minutes. So depends on how fast you're going and everything and how you feel. But really, if you get hungry or thirsty, it's probably too late, so we want to avoid that. Post-workout, recover with protein and carbs, but don't take it too seriously. I've been known to have a massive burger after the marathon. Celebrate, you just ran like this race of your life, it's totally fine. But food is meant to be enjoyed, so don't take it too seriously. So that's it from the presentation standpoint. I know Terry, you've already had this recipe before, but if you'd like, you can have it again. Some overnight oats. So that's what we started with, and it's a little different. I put blueberries and hazelnuts in this one. And next we'll do the energy bite. So this energy bite is not the one you have a recipe for, and I know I don't have the overnight oats recipe in your packet of materials, but I'll make sure you guys get those. This energy bite is a carrot, tart cherry, almond butter, there's oats in it. I didn't realize I put oats in every recipe you guys are having today. I like them, but I didn't realize I put them in all three. They are nice because they're gluten-free, so if anyone had that problem, we had that covered. But tart cherries, carrots, this one doesn't last quite as long as the one that you have a recipe for, the peanut butter energy bites, because there's carrots in there, so you're having a few more perishable items. But if you keep them in a really tight container, you should be able to keep the energy bites for a couple weeks, no problem. So they're rolled in pecans and there's some almond butter, and I used honey to sweeten, but you could also do agave syrup if that's what you have at home. Corn syrup also works, but I like the sugar profile a little bit better for honey and agave. Ooh, rolling. There you go. Thanks. You didn't realize you're going to be passing out bites. Do you have two plates? I don't know. Yes. So this would be an option like in the middle of the day, you're about to head to your workout, you need a quick snack. They're essentially like homemade Lara bars. So very similar. There's some flax meal in there, which that's going to have some protein as well as omega-3s. Flax seed, you need to make sure is ground before you use it, because you won't get any of the benefit. If you just eat the seeds whole, essentially going to go right through you. Chia seeds you can eat whole and you'll get all the benefit, which is nice. So if you are used to having the flax seeds whole, get a coffee grinder and you can grind them down. Or you can just buy the flaxseed meal and it's already done for you. Thank you. All right, so next I'm going to you're going to have your beet berry smoothie samples. Look at that timing. To wash down your... So these are from the smoothie bar. We've got a bunch of different smoothies that you can get up there. This is one of my favorites, obviously, because of the beets, but the kale smoothie is also good. What I like about the smoothies is all of our smoothies are less than, most of them are less than 200 calories per serving for the small, and every 10th one will be free with your Mariano's card. Also, it's all fruit, whole vegetable going into there, so there's nothing else in there. There's no dairy in our smoothies, it's just coconut water or orange juice, or some of them just use spring water. So it's just fruits and vegetables. You can ask them to add a boost of something like chia seed or protein powder, but that will change the nutritional profile, so just keep that in mind. And then I'm just going to cook up these black bean burgers. So this would be another example of a kind of a higher carbohydrate thing that you could have the night before or for lunch. I like these because they're really easy. There's very few ingredients, just some black beans, ketchup, mustard. I know it sounds weird, but it works. Onion, garlic powder, and oats, again, because apparently I love oats today. And I'm serving it on a sprouted grain. We were out of the dinner rolls, which I wanted to make little sliders for you guys, so we're going to just do a slice of bread. Sprouted grains are actually a little bit higher in protein and easier on your digestive system, because they've essentially, when you remember in science class, you sprouted a grain or a bean when you were a kid, that made all those amino acids active, making it a complete protein. So it's just a little bit more nutrition you can get out of bread. I really like them. This is a local baker, Angelic, so you can find it over in the bread aisle. We sell a few other things. The other thing I really love that Angelic makes is a pizza crust. It's a sprouted grain pizza crust. It serves four. I get maybe two servings out of it, just saying. There's two pizza crusts in each package. And it's only 100 calories per quarter. So you can have like half of it, top it with a lot of vegetables, some sauce, a little bit of cheese, and you've got dinner for less than 500 calories. I find when I'm marathon training and getting the really high mileage weeks, I have to eat volume, high volume foods. And that's one. I'll eat a lot of vegetables, a lot of salads, just because it can get have a really big portion without having a super ton of calories. And it fills you up a little bit longer than something that maybe is more calorie dense but not high volume, like a cheeseburger or fried foods. All right, so while I make these, you guys can ask questions. I wrote on that last slide some of the services I offer from a one-on-one standpoint, so that's outside of Mariano's. And then Matt is going to serve you some salads after he grabs garbage. You didn't know you would be eating so well today, right? So what questions, you guys? You must have some. Anything. The marathon course. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. We have a mic for questions.
Testing. It's on. Okay.
You're good.
I was wondering, as far as like total calorie intake, how do you know if you're eating too much, not enough? Is it based on how you feel, or is there a number that you should base it on?
I would base it more on how you feel. Yes, you could definitely figure out your numbers specifically. I think the best rule of thumb I can suggest is 100 calories per mile is what you burn. So if you are running 20 miles, that's 2,000 calories in addition to what you need just to live. And then it depends a little bit on your daily activity as well. So it really varies depending on the person, but it could be on the day you do a 20 miler, anywhere from 3,500 to 5,000 calories, just depending on that day, which can seem overwhelming. But one of the apps that I actually do like a lot is that Map My Run will do, you can put in your height, your weight, and your activity level, and it spits it out, but then it also incorporates if you do their tracking, so you put in how many miles you ran that day, it'll incorporate that into its kind of recommendation for how much you should get per day. And it's pretty accurate, because I do, when I do the personal ones, I sort of see where they come out on there as well, and it's very similar. So, nice free app. If you're like, nerdy like me and like to track things. So these salads are from our $6 and $10 meal case. It's upstairs in the deli, but every store sells $6 and $10 meals. They're a great option, especially for runners. You're short for time, you're starving, you don't feel like cooking. One entree, two sides for $6. The only ones that are $10 are some higher cuts of meat, so things like, I think a beef tenderloin is $10. There's salmon in there, chicken. I think you can do four sides if you're vegetarian, so that is an option too. Because right now I don't think we have a vegetarian option for the entree. But for the sides, these are two options that you can get that are better for you. Obviously, we're in the business of selling food. Some of the sides in there, not so healthy. The twice-baked stuffed potato and the mac and cheese come to mind. So just balance it out. But these kale salads are really great if you've never had kale like this before. Yeah. So you can make the salad. Nice. Yeah, it's great. And then I think you've got a quinoa salad too, and I always include that in case you've never had quinoa before. Everybody had quinoa? So quinoa is just a whole grain that actually is higher. It's complete protein. It has all the proteins of all the amino acids that make up a protein. So it's a great source of protein, especially for vegetarians. Oop, we're in a little dark here. So, all right, any other questions? Must be some. Well, I'm glad to hear everybody's eating breakfast, because that's one it's very common you hear people aren't doing. Nothing else? Come on, guys. I like questions. Well, what did everyone like the most so far? The protein ball. Nice. We could tell you a little bit more about the other handouts. So Siggy's gave us coupons. So you got one of those, as well as one of their substitution and recipes handouts. There's also iHeart Quinoa samples and iHeart Quinoa coupon. What else did I put in there? A smoothie handout. There's a Health Key brochure. So Health Keys is in. Ooh, I'm not going to forget. Hey, Matt, can you get the guacamole out of there? Thank you. So the iHeart Quinoa is great. It's like another quinoa way you can have quinoa. It's in the near popcorn and nuts and stuff like that, so you can find those. Thanks. I'm not as familiar with the Healthy Life. Where do you get, is that in our regular? I don't think it's sprouted. That might be the only difference. Mm-hmm. This is 60 calories a slice, which is great. It's got, I think, 3 grams of protein and 2 grams of fiber, which is what I look for. I also look for the ingredient list, making sure the first ingredient is always a whole wheat, whole grain. I also look where sugar is on in the ingredient list, because we want sugar in bread, but we don't want it to be the up at the top of the ingredient list. You need sugar in bread is there for the yeast to eat, but it doesn't need to be like ingredient number 2 or 3. So I always look at where sugar is. Okay. Can you help pass these out? I'm just going to do open face here. A little guacamole. Healthy fat, right? So normally I get these cute little dinner rolls and you have a slider, but we're improvising today. There. Thanks. Thank you. Oh. Put it in your waiting waitress. Wait, yeah. Got it? Thank you. And I'll just hand you this one because you're right there. Okay, so I'm more coming. I just couldn't fit them all in my pan here at the same time. So you could ask questions, general nutrition too, doesn't have to be specific to All right. Nothing else? Okay. Does anyone want more overnight oats? Stuffed? Questions about the race? Who's first time? Two? First time ever? And first Chicago? That's exciting. How are you feeling?
Tired.
Nervous?
Hungry.
Hungry, yeah.
I guess that's something I'm wondering about
too. So this is my second time doing the marathon, and last year was my first time, of course. During tapering the 2 weeks, I was grumpy and very unhappy.
Yeah.
And I wondered if I could have changed something nutritionally to help with that.
That's typical taper. I call it the taper tantrums. There is not much you can do from a nutrition standpoint. Just try to make sure your diet's real clean, really healthy as you can. I think for me, it's just about finding, you know, making sure I look at those 2 weeks that I know I'm tapering and I don't schedule anything that I'm going to, like, regret or, you know, just taking care of yourself, like, really being conscious of what you need, letting people know around you that you're probably not going to be the nicest person. It just happens. I have forgotten my keys. What did I do this last time? It was something funny. There was some, I always just do the craziest things during taper week. There's not much you can do about it. But just trust your training. Know that you've done everything you can do to get to this point. And yeah, you don't feel great, but it's all going to feel worth it in 2 weeks. So when do you start the taper then? It's like soon, right? 2 weeks? Okay.
Then it's 12.
I think you usually do about 8 or 10 a week before.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then it's more days off than you're used to. That's what I always struggle with. Because for me, running is also stress relieving, and it's like the one thing that relieves this I can't do. So find alternative outlets, things like yoga if it's not too intensive. I cook a lot, healthy stuff, but I cook a lot. What else did I have done? Go to movies, read more, catch up on the things I hadn't have time for in the higher mileage weeks. Smoking a little, huh? I think there's just that dead zone at like 20 after Chinatown.
Those things where like, if it won't bother you, put your name on your shirt because it's not on your bib, and people will literally be cheering directly at you the entire time. And I love that. My friend didn't want to do it because he was like, okay, it's so distracting if someone's yelling my name, but I love it. I do headphones, but I actually think I ran with one out for a while just because I wanted it.
Sure.
I turn mine down, so I'm listening to my music, but I'm still hearing everything. Yeah, and then when you get someplace where it's like, you know, then I turn it up. But you know, like year that I got hurt and I was booted and I still went to watch my husband run, I made a wrong move and I got on a pink line instead of a green line. So I got off the wrong stop and I was running down the street in my boot trying to catch up with him. And finally got, I wasn't going to make it. So I stopped and here he comes and I'm like, yeah. And he ran right by me because his music was so loud. He didn't hear anything. I'm like, and then I start trying to chase after him and then I start crying and then I decided like, okay,
no,
suck it up. Like, it's not a big deal.
If you have people that are going to watch you,
have them hold something.
Might have been your advice or Carrie's advice last year, but like, set up, just have them like tell you ahead of time if they're going to be on the right or on the left. There's that blue line that you might have already heard about that's like, if you stick exactly on it, that's the 26.2. But like, my tracker thing probably got messed up when you, at the very beginning, you go under.
Yeah, yeah.
But it said that I ran over 27 miles because I wasn't on that line the whole time. So if you want to like see people, like last year was my first year, and I actually stopped and like, took pictures with my family, like gave them hugs, and super happy and excited, and I didn't really care if it affected my time because I was just so happy to be there. So like, that, my advice is to really, really enjoy it your first year, because if you do it a second time, then you have a time to beat. So like this year, I'm really putting a lot of pressure on myself because I have a time in mind. Last year I was like, I just am excited to be here.
Yeah.
And I was happy with my time. It, like, I would have liked it to be a little bit faster, but everybody does. But I don't regret at all stopping and saying hi to everybody and like high-fiving people and like giving like high fives to little kids on the side. Like, I don't regret that at all. My advice is to do it.
Yeah.
I second that about letting people know what side of the street you run on, because there's nothing worse than seeing your person way over there and you're like, oh
yeah,
darn. Terry just said, as Margaret was talking, that I've been known to, like, if I was, like, I instead of thinking about it, like, 26.2 miles, I would be like, okay, you know, some people have their splits. I was like, Kurt, mile six, Jim, mile 10. And that's, like, how I ran it, because, you know, I'm like, I'm not going to win, but I am going to have a good time. So that's what I would do. I would just run from person to person, and you're going to see them, like, you'll see them looking, and then you run up, and they're like, oh, and they're trying to get their camera out really fast. Terry teases me because my husband missed my picture, and that's the benefit of me being slow and him being fast, is he's there to cheer me on. I'm like, you didn't get my picture? Hold on. You know? So, you gotta have fun with it.
Yeah.
No one here is probably gonna win.
Darn it. I know.
My heart. You have won my heart. Yeah, that's that beet juice.
Past couple of years, every time I always get sick 2 weeks before the race. I don't know if it's going to happen again this year, but the last 2 years, I got sick 2 weeks before the race. And I don't know if that affected. I ended up cramping up after the 15th.
Yeah.
Second one, first one after the 18th. I don't know if that had to, that had an effect to
the
it.
Cramping could be related to electrolytes. And if you're sick, it's almost like you need more fluids than you normally would. So it would probably be hard to keep your fluid and your electrolytes up on top of what you're normally used to when you're sick on top of that. So to prevent the sick, I would just really focus on your fruits and vegetables, vitamin C, zinc, really increase that those 2 weeks out. And hopefully that'll prevent that from happening. I will say with any activity over an hour, we are in a state of immunocompromised post-activity. So you are more likely to get sick after the marathon, after long runs, and that's why it's so important to fuel adequately post-run, but also to make sure you're focusing on those vitamins and minerals and taking care of yourself. So getting the sleep that you need, really focusing on those things that we know we should do, but we don't always do. It's Columbus Day, which is really nice, so maybe your office offers that as a floating holiday or something. Yeah, I've done that too.
Fleet Feet will engrave your, I'm on camera and I put my teeth. They'll engrave your medal for free and they give you like free 312 beers.
Terry will probably be there doing massage, right?
Yeah, they give you like 5 minute massages for free. And then you can like drop your medal off and then go somewhere. So my friends and I did what you're not supposed to do and we went out drinking like the whole day to celebrate because we'd all done our first marathon. So I'm not going to do that this year because I regretted it by the end of the night. But it's really fun to go and like have a full day, just like walk around. Like you obviously don't want to sit down at a desk the
yeah,
day
don't
after.
Sit or sleep all day.
Or and like hydrate and enjoy the day.
You can get a massage.
You want to talk about post-race massage?
Yes. All right, post-race massage. I've been a massage therapist for almost 22 years, and to be honest with you, the massage that you get usually after a marathon, like right away that day, is just going to be kind of like a little just. And, you know, it's just a, you know, calming down, saying hello, you know, just saying, okay, you're no longer trying to kill your body, you know, because your body is in a sympathetic nervous system response. So what's happening is your body, you just put it through, you know, running almost 30 miles. I mean, all said and done, between walking around and doing this and doing that. And your body is, like, rebelling. So you've got a lot of adrenaline and everything. So you don't want to do anything too hardcore. So the massages that'll be at the event after the marathon, those are just right in the race day space. Will be, you know, just, oh, I like that race day space. She's good. But that'll be just like a 15-20 minute little tune up, stretching and this and that. The day after the marathon, I won't see any of my clients. Maybe some of my clients that I've been seeing for years and years and years, I'll see for if they're really like something happened, you know, and they need something. But to be honest with you, if your race is on a Sunday, for example, I won't, you know, give a massage for pre-event past probably Thursday evening if I've seen you before. If I've never seen you before, like never had my hands on your body, honestly, it's probably going to be Thursday morning, Wednesday, something like that. If you've got really something going on, maybe I'll do something, but really, really easy, because I need to know how your body's going to respond to massage. Post-race, I won't see you until Tuesday, because your body's still going through with adrenaline. It's still reabsorbing everything. And you have to, I have to know if this is sore or if this is injury. And because, I mean, your body still doesn't know. And to be honest with you, you're probably going to feel worse on Tuesday than you do on Monday.
Yep.
So, you know, but at least then, you know, you're gonna want to do, you know, like you'll be doing the stairs, you know, really slow, or go up backwards or sideways and all that kind of stuff. But honestly, either you're going to see all sorts of promotions. Oh, get your post-race massage, you know, hour-long massage. People want two-hour massages. Don't fall for it. Okay, so that's that. More on that later.
Well, yeah, totally. That's okay. We've kept you over an hour, so my contact info is on that last slide. So you've got my email, kind of where you can find me on social media, my blog. But feel free to reach out if you have questions or anything comes up in the next few weeks. Totally, I'll answer. It's totally fine. Yeah, you're welcome. And I'll follow up, like I said, with the recipes that weren't included in the pack. Well, all of them, just so you have them for those that are on there too. Yeah.